In this video, you're going to learn how to solve four hard SAT math questions. But before we start the lesson, I want to be completely honest with you. You could skip ahead to each of the questions and still benefit from my explanations. But if you want a significant advantage over any hard SAT math question, then spend 10 minutes of your time viewing the entire video. In 10 minutes, you will learn the anatomy of a hard SAT math question, and that's exactly what you need to get the score you want. It's important that we talk about the prepping you've done so far. That way, we can see what went wrong and how you can improve. These are graphs of SAT score improvement for the average student, and they're modeled using data directly from the College Board. Notice the curves flatline at 21 hours of prepping. If you've prepped a lot and you're experiencing the same trend, it tells me two things. One, you have the math you need to get the hard questions right. And two, however, your approach to hard questions, well, it could use a little work. If you haven't done a lot of prepping, then watch this video so you don't have to experience the same thing that everyone else is experiencing. Here are two questions. Which one do you think is harder, question one or question two? Most students would pick question one, but we're gonna work through both and see how they play out. But after that, we're gonna compare both questions and break them down in a way that will help you to solve any hard SAT math question. As I read through this problem, I see we have a triangle with a base, a height, and an area. And then I see that all three of those things, base, height, and area, are gonna be changed by percentages. So I think we should start by writing the formula for the area of a triangle. And there it is, one half base times height is area. Next step is, since the values of the base and the height are going to be changed, I think we should insert those in there and just see where it goes. So we pop those in, and then, oh, we can calculate the area of a triangle very easily. Now, had you not written the formula in the first place and had you not put those in, you might not have noticed this. The next step is we're going to be changing all three of those things by percent changes. So we need this formula here. And then what we're going to do is we're going to stack those into the equation. So next step, we're going to stack those in, and there they are. And then I'm looking at what I've got now, and what I see is it's a very messy, busy equation, but I have one equation, one unknown. We just pop this into Desmos and let it do the work. So let's do that. So there I am, typing it in, and then don't forget to change the equal sign into a tilde so we get a value out, and then there's the value. At this point, we've done a lot of the work, and it's very natural to get all excited about this beautiful round answer that we have. But there is a final step. It's really important to reread the very last part of the question and make sure we're giving it back what they're asking for. They're asking for P, we found P, great. So they're asking for P percent or 100 times P or anything else. So we're done. Now let's look at the problem on the right. The first thing I notice is there are 9 lines of text, and then there are bizarre technical terms and a crazy formula. To me, this is good news, because normally what it means is the problem actually isn't that hard to do. All you gotta do is dial in on the few parts of the problem that you need to get the job done. I usually start with the equation. And when I'm looking at the equation, I see an R and I see a P. And I see that we're trying to find P, so obviously we don't have that. So what's R? So I read down below and I see that, you know, it's the only number I got is 6.25%. And what is that? It's a decrease in the beam's triangular cross-section area, and I look right above and it says the beam's triangular cross-section area decreases by R percent. So R percent is 6.25%. So I'm going to rewrite the 6.25% as 6.25 over 100 because I changed it into a number, and then the R is a 6.25. So I load that into the equation, and what do I notice? I notice I have one equation, one unknown. That means I'm just going to type it into Desmos and let it do the work. So here I'm typing it in, and then don't forget to use a tilde instead of the equal sign. And there's my answer, 25. The final step, as always, is to reread the final part of the question and make sure you're giving them back exactly what they're asking for. What do they want? They want P. What did I find? I found P. Good, we're done. Did you notice that both questions are similar, but at the same time, very different? Now that you've worked through both questions, let me ask you again, which question you think is harder, question one or question two? Now we're going to compare both questions side by side and break them down using important SAT math question design perspectives. Understanding these perspectives is what will help your SAT score grow dramatically. First, the SAT mostly measures reasoning and problem solving skills in two areas. One, of course, in math, but with a limited number of math concepts and formulas. And two, in these test question design elements. Let's see where these design elements show up in the questions we just did. For the question on the left, the first thing I notice is big time layered reasoning. First, you have to read the question and interpret it. Second, there's not just one concept, there are multiple concepts. So you got to use geometry, percent, algebra, and Desmos. The second thing I notice is abstract representation. So there's a lot of information in this question, and it's just all words. There's no drawing, and there's no organization of information. So that makes this a rather abstract question. The third test question design element that I notice, and it's pretty clear, multiple steps under time pressure. And now let's look at the problem on the right. The first thing I notice is disguised simplicity. I mean, there's all that stuff, and in the end, all you needed was R and to use Desmos. Clearly disguised simplicity. The second thing I notice about the problem is the distractor trap. They give you R percent, but in the equation you need R. The second perspective is super important because it's the opposite of what most people think they need to do to get better at solving hard SAT math questions. The second perspective is the SAT writers severely limit the number of math concepts and formulas, and for two reasons. One, the test is short and they want you to focus on reasoning and problem solving skills. And two, they don't want you to miss a question just because you didn't know a formula. What this means to you is that you don't need this math concept and formula toolbox. Instead, you need this one. Here's a list of all the math concepts and formulas we used to do the last two questions. If you know them all, you can get the questions right, even though they're hard. With the first question, we built an algebraic equation from the given information, and we started by using the formula for the area of a triangle. Then we used basic percent knowledge to change P percent into a number, and we inserted the percent change formula into our algebraic equation. And finally, we used Desmos to evaluate our equation. But in question two, even though all five concepts are baked into the question, we only needed to use two of them to get our answer. We used basic percents to change R percent into a number, and then we used Desmos to evaluate the equation. The third perspective is way more important than most people think, and it can easily change an expected outcome from a perfect score to an average score. The third perspective is that the SAT is designed so you experience STS while reasoning and problem solving. STS is stress, time pressure, and high stakes. Let's suppose you can work through SAT questions at home, no problem. But on the real test, you struggle. Then it's likely you experience STS during your test. How do you overcome STS? Let's suppose you're working through a percent question and you miss it. For any reason, it doesn't matter, you got it wrong. Then find every percent question in the digital SAT PDFs. Then, using what you've learned here, carefully read and compare each question, looking for patterns. Now try this. Pause the video and work through these next two hard questions on your own. You're working through them, of course, to get the right answer, but focus on using what you've learned here. Then, when you come back, I'll walk you through my own thoughts on these questions. The first thing I noticed about question three is it's less abstract than question one, so the SAT writers would consider this easier. The reason it's less abstract is the given information is organized into a table. I'm gonna go ahead and quickly set this one up. We have two triangles that have areas that are related. So I'm gonna write the area formula for triangle X, and I'm gonna load in my values, and I get A is 24. Okay, and that's kind of a dead end there. So now I'm gonna move on to triangle Y. I'm gonna set that one up using triangle area formula. So I'm gonna load in the lengths, and I have that that's equal to A. Now they don't give us A in the chart, but the words below give us the information we need to construct it. And basically triangle Y, the area is 6.25% less than triangle X. So I'm gonna write in the area of triangle X, insert the percent change formula with the 6.25 in there, and now I'm good to go. I have an equation that's the exact same one as question one. I just insert into Desmos and evaluate it. The only difference between question one and question four is question four has a drawing and it has a distractor trap at the end where it asks for 5P instead of just P. The numbers on the drawing are the same as the numbers in the sentence. So the only purpose for the drawing is to make it easier for you to visualize. I'm not gonna bother working this out because you could actually do the problem without even having the drawing, and then it is the same problem as question one. At this point, you might be wondering why no one else is teaching this. I have a unique perspective that comes with a lot of highly specialized experience. Over the last 30 years, I've helped thousands of students raise their SAT math scores. As a math education consultant, I help schools troubleshoot their standardized tests and help their teachers improve their student math performance. On top of that, I've written thousands of pages of math curriculum, and I am a mathematician. If you have any questions, leave them in the comments section, and I will do my very best to answer each one of them.